Well, hey, good morning. It's good to be with you this morning, even if it's only digitally on the big screens. Most of you probably know that I tested positive for COVID a week or two ago, and I've been isolated at home with Lynn for the past 10 days or so. And this is the first day that the Licking County Health Department says it's okay for me to be out and about, but I did not want to risk playing it that close, so I asked the elders and the staff if I could speak remotely this morning, which they all said was okay after they pulled their face masks up a little bit more securely around their faces, which is still a wise thing for all of us to do this morning, for our own sakes, but also for the sakes of our neighbors that we might not even know that we might be infecting. But this morning, I want to talk to you about brighter things. I want to talk to you about the joy of serving Jesus. We used to sing a song about that when I was young. The joy of serving Jesus every day. Joy because of what we get to do and who we get to do it for, but also who we get to do it with. You may remember when you were a kid looking up at your mom or dad, daydreaming of the day when you'd get to do all the stuff that big people got to do. I remember going on service calls with my dad to fix TVs in people's homes. And I can't tell you the number of times that I was asked that when I grew up, was I going to be a TV repairman like my dad? Well, I was too timid to say so at the time, but I couldn't wait to grow up and do big people's stuff like my dad someday. I couldn't wait until I could help people not only at home with their TVs, but at church. And in the hospital and at church camp and on the mission field, up and down the creek and into and out of the baptistry, like I saw my dad help so many people. I couldn't wait until I learned the Bible well enough that I could teach Bible lessons and I could give devotions and I could preach sermons. In fact, I kept blank paper in the back of my Bible as a little boy so that I could take notes during the sermon time. Always my favorite part of the church service. After which, I would run up to the pulpit and compare my notes to the preacher's to see how close my notes came to his. Well, why did I do that? Why? Because I couldn't wait until I grew up and I got to do some of all this big people stuff that other people were doing, especially when you consider who we get to do it for. You know, one of the Lord's greatest workers who ever lived said this: whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you'll receive the inheritance as a reward. And then that reminder, you are serving the Lord Christ. Man, it's amazing when you think about it. Who is it that we get to serve? Not just what we get to do when we serve, but who do we get to do it for? Because it's not as if God needs anything from us. It's just such a privilege and an honor to get to serve Him. Now, next week, our life groups are going to begin by looking at King David's desire to build the Lord a temple in the Old Testament, something the Lord never asked for, and yet the Lord allowed King David to do, and something He allowed His son Solomon to finish. Now, why? Not because the Lord needed it or even the Lord wanted it, but because King David and King Solomon wanted to do it for the Lord, and the Lord let them. What a privilege. Think what a privilege it is of all that the Lord allows us to do for Him. Again, not because He needs it, but just because of the pure privilege and honor of doing something for Him. One commentator I read preparing for this message talked about all the ways that God could have chosen to share this amazing gospel story that we get to share, how men and women can be forgiven of their sins through Christ's death on the cross for their sins. God could have written that gospel in the clouds or had the wind ring out the good news to the whole world. God could have used any number of aspects of His creation, but instead He chose us. He chose His children. He chose men and women to carry the message of Jesus and minister that message for Him. Man, what a privilege, what a joy, what we get to do and who we get to do it for. But folks, as great as those joys are, there's another joy that our text this morning speak of, and that's the joy of realizing who we get to do this with. before closing his letter to the church at Rome. The Apostle Paul in Romans 16 mentions 28, 29, 30 individuals by name. Greek and Roman names that might sound strange to us, but names of individuals that had become great friends of the Apostle Paul, had become co-laborers with him. Names like Epaphras and Andronicus and Junia and Apuleius and Urbanus and Staches and Apelles and Aristobulus and Herodian and the family of Narcissus, Persis and Syncritus, Phlegon, Hermes, Patropus, Hermas, Philologos, Julia, Nereus, and Olympus, and all the saints who are with them, Paul says. Strange sounding names to us. Would have been strange sounding names to Saul of Tarsus also, had he never seen the light and come to Christ on the road to Damascus and accepted the Lord's call to go into all the world, especially the Greco-Roman part of the world, and preach Jesus Christ. Has Saul simply stayed home and remained a Hebrew of Hebrews, he would have never met these individuals, and he might have stumbled over these Greco-Roman names as badly as I did this morning. But not now, because now these are well-known individuals to the apostles. These are partners in crime with Paul in preaching Christ around the Mediterranean world. These are men and women who are now working in the church at Rome as well, and Paul claims them as his own. His friends, his dear Priscilla and Aquila, close companions and co-workers with the Apostle Paul ever since meeting the fellow tent maker in Corinth, where they opened up their hearts to Paul and they opened up their homes to the Apostle of Christ as well. And then they followed him out of Corinth into Ephesus, where Priscilla and Aquila continued to open up their Ephesian home for the cause of Christ. In fact, in his first letter back to the Corinthian Christians, the Apostle Paul wrote this. He said, "The churches of Asia send you greetings. Aquila and Priscilla, together with the church in their house, send you hearty greetings in the Lord as well." They're still opening up their house. That's what happens when you open up your heart and your home to the service of the Lord. You become close to a whole bunch of other Christ followers. You become friends with them, with men, with women, that you wouldn't have even known had it not been for your passion to serve Christ, crossing with their passion to serve Christ as well. That's just who Priscilla and Aquila were. They were friends of Paul, co-laborers with an apostle of Christ, laboring with those who were laboring also and loving it. And Paul was happy to count Priscilla and Aquila as friends of his. That's how he felt about Phoebe as well. Paul begins this whole section of greetings in Romans 16 by saying, "I commend to you our sister Phoebe, a servant of the church at Cenchrea." Another friend of Paul. Now, how did that happen? We don't know, but through some mutual service in the cause of Christ, somewhere along each of their journeys, their paths crossed. And I want you to think about this. Phoebe was the name of a Greek goddess who was the grandmother in Greek mythology to Apollo, the god of the sun, and grandmother to Artemis, goddess of the moon. That's who Paul's Phoebe was probably named after when she was born, which means Paul's Phoebe was probably born into a pagan family and named after a pagan god. It would have been surprising if she wasn't. But somewhere along the way, this young girl born into a pagan family, somewhere along the way, she was introduced to Christ. And she gave her life to Christ. And she gave her life to serving Christ, where her life crossed paths with Paul's life. As did virtually everyone on this Romans 16 list. Because of their service to Christ, and because somehow their service to Christ crossed paths with Paul's service to Christ, they all became close friends together. Paul calls Priscilla and Aquila my fellow workers in verse 3. He says, "Greet Andronicus and Junia, my kinsmen," in verse 7. And then he adds, they're well known to all the apostles, not just to me, but because of their service, all the apostles know them as well. And they were in Christ before me, Paul says. Think of that. Greet Urbanus, Paul says in verse 9, our fellow worker. Greet those workers in the Lord, Tryphena and Tryphosis. And greet the beloved Persis, who has worked hard in the Lord. I love those names, Tryphena and Tryphosis. Those names sound almost poetic the way they roll off the tongue. But what I like more is what those Greek names mean. The name Tryphena means dainty, and the name Tryphosis means delicate. Here we have dainty and delicate. Two of the workhorses in the church at Rome. I love that. And I've seen that on more than one occasion. Looks can be very deceiving. Sometimes I've seen the most dainty and delicate be the hardest workhorses for the Lord. And then there was Rufus in verse 13. He's chosen in the Lord, the Bible says. Many commentators wonder if this Rufus is not the same man that's referred to in Mark's Gospel, chapter 15, verse 21, where it says, the Roman soldiers compelled a passerby by the name of Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry the cross of Jesus for him. Man, wouldn't that be something? A young man who may have seen his own father shoulder the cross of Christ, and then follow in his father's footsteps and growing up to shoulder a cross of his own. And in the process, joining a long line of others shouldering the cross of Christ as well. Rubbing shoulders with them, enduring blisters and splinters with them, and becoming great friends of all of them in the process. That's what Paul is expressing in this text this morning. Paul is not just saying thank you to all these workers who helped him. He's not just patting fellow workers on the back and encouraging them to keep up the good work. Now, Paul does that in other places. And in fact, that's just exactly what he does in my favorite verse in all the Bible, 1 Corinthians 15:58, where Paul says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know your labor is not in vain in the Lord. And there's a time and a place for that kind of encouragement. But that's not what we read Paul doing this morning as he closes his letter to the Romans. He's not saying thank you or even trying to encourage them to keep on doing what they have been doing. Paul is genuinely missing these folks, his friends. He's wishing he could be with them again. He's remembering how he served with them. And he's actually wishing he could serve with them again. And he's asking the Roman Christians to give his friends a great big hug for him. In fact, that's what the Greek word translated greet in our text. It's used 17 to 18 times in these 16 verses. Greet one another. That's what the Greek word means. It literally means to facilitate a union by the enfolding of arms. The enfolding of arms. That's what we're missing in these digital times. Yes, we can fist bump and elbow bump or wave to one another behind our face masks. And yes, I can FaceTime my dad or zoom in to my extended family from time to time. I can even digitally project my sermon from our back patio to the church screens this morning. But there's something lost without the human touch, without a handshake, without a hug from time to time. And that's a loss that can't be underestimated, especially between close friends, friends who've served in the trenches together, friends who've gone through tough times together, both thick and thin. And Paul had been through his share of both of those times with these Christian friends. Some of these people had been like kinsmen to him, verse 11. Some had been like a mother to him, verse 13. Some had even been fellow prisoners with him, verse 7. And there are bonds that are formed through such times. There are lifetime friendships that are forged through such times. And Paul misses those times, and he misses those times with his friends. He wishes he could be with them again. He wishes he could throw both his arms around them, but he can't. So Paul, from his safe distance, he tells the Romans to give each of his friends a big hug, would you? And a kiss for him, he says. Romans 16, 16. Greet one another with a holy kiss, Paul says. All the churches of Christ greet you. All the churches wish they could throw their arms around and enfold you. Folks, there's joy in serving Jesus, I tell you. And not just because of what we get to do, and not just because of who we get to do it for, but because of who we get to do it with. And the great friendships that are forged in that fire. I've got to worship with so many of you down through the years, but I've also got to work with many of you through the week as well. Not just teaching lessons and preaching sermons and singing great songs of the faith, but we've mopped floors together and mowed grass together and served suppers together. We sat up and torn down tables and tents and chairs and washed dishes and took out trash, changed diapers and unstopped toilets. We've dried out overflowed baptistries and cleaned out flooded basements. We've drug ball fields and scrubbed picnic shelters. We've raked leaves together. We've cleaned out rain gutters together. We've built wheelchair ramps together. We've drove church buses together and fixed the buses when they broke down. We've trimmed limbs and cut down trees and burned brush and put on church camps and revivals and VBSs. We've walked through neighborhoods. We've put flyers on doors. We've visited inmates. We've visited patients. We've prayed with residents in nursing homes. We've cooked breakfasts for students before school, and then we met around flagpoles for prayer with them. We've torn buildings down. We've put new buildings up. We've put siding on houses and insulation in attics. We've tore off and put on new roofs. We've built habitat houses together. We've helped build new church houses as well. We've gone on mission trips where we built church camps, tore off and put on front stoops. We put up and took down Christmas stables and nativity scenes so many times, we just wore them out. I've worked with some of you while the sun was shining as well as long after dark. I've seen some of you work in all kinds of weather just to get a job done. I've watched you shiver through assignments when it was cold and sweat like there was no tomorrow when it was hot. I've seen you get up early. I've seen you stay up late just to get a job done. I've seen your patience, and I've heard what you said when you hit your thumb with a hammer. I've seen you josh and joke with one another and have the grandest of time on some of the hardest of jobs. I've seen you paint and stain and sweep and dust and clean, pack lunches and take meals to houses and end up cleaning those kitchens before you left them. I've watched you stick to a project of putting a swing set together consisting of thousands of parts and hundreds of steps out in the hot sun, and yet I've watched you never give up until the job was done. To this day, I have no idea what Kum O or Roger McDonald sound like when they sing, but I know how they swing a hammer because I've seen them, and they've seen how weak I swing one as well, and that's how we became brothers. I've seen Roger McLean shiver like a drowned rat in an unheated baptistry just to give every man on our leadership team the experience of how to baptize a person into Christ should the opportunity ever present itself. And I've heard him say it once, I've heard Dick Nether say it 100 times, how he'll give it a shot, whatever it is that I'd ask him to try to do. I've seen Jody German and Carol Ogg and Martha Poulton and Janet Wilkin and so many others jump in and take over for Jenny Priest and Angie Miller and Emma Jean Somm and Ann Wisner and Jeanette Nyberger in preparing funeral luncheons for grieving families in our community. And they've all become friends in that church kitchen in the process of doing it. We got Ben and Amy and Avriel as part of our church family, largely because of the way this church jumped in and helped them carve out a place on Rockhaven Road. Now Ben and Amy and Avriel have jumped in and joined us in serving Jesus with all kinds of projects around here themselves. There's camaraderie that comes with serving Christ, I tell you. There's a real joy that comes in serving Jesus with those who are serving Jesus also. Laboring with those who are laboring also and loving it. And I wish I had a dozen more lifetimes to do it all with you all over again. Not just because of what we got to do and who we got to do it but also because of who I got to do it with as well, and the great friendships that came out of that. And I'm praying that I've whetted some people's appetites here this morning. That was part of what I was hoping to do with this backyard barbecue. Lynn and I wish we could invite you over after church, but the rules do not permit it. But could I have whetted someone's appetite and made someone hungry to serve Jesus as well? Could there be someone here who is starting to lick your lips, wondering what all this serving Jesus with all these other serving Jesus might be like? Why not jump in and join us and see if there really is joy in serving Jesus? This Jesus who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is now seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Let's pray, could we? Lord, thank you for serving us, for giving all of yourself to us, for saving us. And now, Lord, help us look around and see how we might be able to serve you, what we can do, and remembering who we're doing it for, but also the joy of understanding who we're doing it with. Thank you for giving us one another. May some more one another's jump in and join us this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.